Hey guys, welcome back. Thanks so much for joining me. Today we're going to look at moveable colour specifically to address some of the things that I've seen you guys doing and to basically improve the finished look. Hey guys, welcome or welcome back. If you haven't already, please do press the subscribe button and click the bell icon. The bell icon helps you out because it gives you a notification every single time I upload a video. I upload a video every week and sometimes more than that if I feel like it. Welcome, you are joining me quite early in the morning and we're going to sort out all of your moveable colour woes. So on the screen right now, you can see an image that I've literally just brought into Photoshop, ran a couple of adjustments on it to alter the colour, and I'm pretty much at the stage where I want to add moveable colour. So, moveable colour was mentioned in a full edit video, which is quite complex, and that is linked above. So today we're literally going to drill down right into the moveable colour section. You guys know from that video, if you did watch it, that first thing we need to do is mask out the dog. So I need to get a clean cut around the subject. So how I'm going to do that, I'm going to make sure I'm clicking on a layer with him on it, which this one is, and I'm going to click select subject, and then Photoshop will pick the subject for us. We're going to fine tune that and select a mask. I'm not going to include that in this video because it does get a bit lengthy, but after you've watched this video, or you can open it in a new tab, head up to watch the masking video. Okie dokie, so when you have a mask, so I've got the mask here, over here, and when you have that mask ready, then you need to create your moveable colour. So, you know, been here before, down into the adjustment layer section, and up to gradient. And within gradient, we then want to change it to a radial. If I'm moving too quick, you know, you can either replay this video or you can watch it in slow motion by clicking the settings icon on the video viewer. And then you want to go into your colour and into the colour of that and just put it on white because it's always easier to see on white. Then the next thing to do is you need to kind of assess what the scale of the movable colour is going to be. And for me, I'm going to use quite a big one. So with that done, you just click OK on everything and that puts it back here. We want to move this mask to here. We don't need to copy it because we don't need the mask on this layer that we put it on. So we just click and drag. And what that's done is that's put the mask the other way round. So the mask itself is stopping that movable colour from being at the other side of the subject. So what we need to do is we need to invert the mask. We can do that by clicking on the mask itself and then doing Command and I on a Mac or Control and I on a Windows. Then the next thing that we really need to do is assess where is this light going to come from. So if we just turn that layer off for a sec, we can see that he is actually, well, he's kind of lit from above, but he is actually more lit from this side because, and we can tell that, because if you look at the shadows on his face, so if you look at this shadow here, that is far lighter than the same shadow at the opposite side. And the same for his nose. This is lighter than this. This is lighter than this. So the direction of the light is coming from up there. If your image is backlit, you can kind of put the movable color wherever you want behind the dog. But if it's not, you would not put this movable color, this light, from this side because it doesn't make any sense. So you have to make sure that you know where the light's coming from. And for me, it's coming from up here. Now I'm gonna make this bigger because I want the light to pass past him, kind of like that. And we need to make sure that it isn't just sort of stuck behind him and small. So we wouldn't do it like that because again, it just makes literally zero sense to the human brain. We have to make sure that these things make sense. So we're gonna put it up at a corner. It doesn't need to be right at the corner if you've got bokeh flares in the background that you could attach it to, but you wouldn't put it sort of just like there because again, it doesn't make sense. So I tend to put the center, which is about there, up into a corner. It doesn't have to be right in there, but basically so that the lightest part is the corner. And you don't have to be in a corner. It can be from above like so. It could be from the side if the light makes sense. But for me today, I'm just going to put it up here. I'm going to make it a bit bigger again, like so. And then what we want to just ignore the mask for a sec. What we want to assess is how is this light going to fall? And this is going to depend on your image. If you've got lots of nice bright, you like a bright style, you're probably going to want to be on screen. So in the layer mode section, this little drop down here, you've got all these options. Now this top section darkens stuff, this section's lightens stuff, this adds contrast, and then the bottom ones affect, you know, your color and your general light. So what we're going to be doing today is I want you guys to focus specifically on lighten screen, and also if you needed to go into a linear dodge, but that is for backlit photos only and you use it with a very light touch. Let me just show you the difference between the two, okay? So this is screen. If you look at the light areas in the image, so the highlights on the leaves, for example, and the highlights where the light hits the floor, with screen enabled, they are lit more. So it lets that differentiation in light come through. If we go on lighten, it just lightens up most of the areas in the image and it decontrasts it. So if you like a matte style, you're going to want to be on lighten. For us today, we're going to use screen, and then you want to go into your opacity section and drop that down. I would not suggest using this super high unless you've got a super bright image, in which case it completely works. But for me, I'm probably going to stick around that general area. You can then go double click back into your gradient and into the color section and into the color picker itself and go into the color section. And once there, you will get a color picker come up. You can then go for a warm gradient. Again, use with care, don't overdo it. So putting color onto that does actually make quite a big difference. So if you look in your history now, between, we've just added a warmth to it. This is before the warmth, this is after the warmth. So it makes quite a big difference. With that now done, you can then assess the general situation in terms of your mask. So I've not gone back in and fine-tuned the mask after doing select a mask. So I'm just gonna make sure I've clicked on my layer, grab my brush, make it nice and big and soft. And I wanna just sort of dust over the areas that I want a little bit of this gradient fill to come into. So the light's coming from behind, it would make sense that he would have some gradient fill on his back. And then also to tie him in, make him look less cut out, grab a low opacity brush, maybe 20%, and just dot that in over the edges. You want to be quite careful when doing this to not overdo it. There is a bad bit of mask there, which I will go in and clean up after this. The cleanup for the mask, that is actually in the masking video, which we've already linked above, and that will be in the description below. But it is worth looking at if you are not a regular masker, shall we say. When you get to lighter areas on the edges, you probably want to push the opacity of the mask a little bit more when you've got movable color on, because that will make it look more like it was backlit in this situation, which is super useful. So with that now in place, we have made quite a big difference to the lighting scene in this image. You could, if you wanted to, push that up even more, make it bigger, make it a different color. It doesn't matter what you want to do. Different situations will call for different applications, so please don't use one thing all of the time because it doesn't always make sense. And you can also always double click back on the gradient to move the color around the picture. I can't get my words out today, guys. You're missing all of my screw-ups, but there are a lot today in process. So to counteract where we've got the light coming in, you can then go ahead and create shade, which is something that I would always recommend. I use a curves, you can use whatever you want to use. I tend to pull down and have some shadow there, and then I will usually invert the mask on that too. Grab a brush and go ahead and add this shadow to certain areas of the image as required, to make sure that everything makes sense again, because there's nothing worse than looking at a picture and knowing that's not going to be like that in real life. So the light's coming from here, there's going to be a shadow here. It's important that we make sure that all of these sections make sense. You'll notice that I've used this technique multiple times, with success. And for me, it personally works really, really well. It's just something that I think everybody should work on, making sure that their light makes sense. The most important thing about movable color is that you have a source point for the light, which makes sense with the light already in the scene, that you connect it to the ground with having some form of a shadow section and making sure that the shadow makes sense. You want to get really comfortable using your layer styles in terms of the different effects that you want. If you look at the difference between lighten in this situation and screen, there is quite a big difference in how it's affecting the image. And of course, the other options would change it even more. So you have to be really aware of what you're actually wanting to achieve, because there is no one size fits all, and what you use is very much dependent on your particular style. So the next thing that I would do with this image is just continue on through my workflow. So I'd then touch up him and do a D-set, which we've already done before on the YouTube channel. We've done everything that I would do to this particular picture. So just head back through videos if you want to know how to create it, including how to shoot it. If this has been useful for you, and I really hope it has, please drop me a note in the comment section below. Make sure you subscribe to this channel and click the bell icon to get those weekly notifications. There is also a blog post on this topic, which I will link in the description below. And of course, we're always on Instagram. So if you haven't already, please do come find us on Instagram. I would really love to see you there. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you again very, very soon.